today, we have so many young people listening to me. So a presentation, because the presentation is ready there, reactions and the interest, I will present it fully or sometimes skip through that. And that will be for a duration of say 45 minutes. And after that, you can have a question answer session for half an hour or a discussion for half an hour. So that's the plan. So then I will begin with the presentation from my side. It's okay?
Yes, sir.
So let me see the presentation going. Hope you are all able to see the presentation. The title of the presentation is Indian Innovations in Space Technology. So this I prepared for you for your discussion today. Maybe one of you can confirm. Okay. Now there could be some delay between I change the slide or sometimes that could be there. So please pardon with me. Some of you may receive the slide a little later. So sometimes I would progress with the talk. Okay. So I begin. Good evening to all of you, for all the participants. Welcome to thanks for the Regional Science Center and Planetarium Calicut for arranging this talk. And talk to you young people. Especially those who have come with so bright eyes and then they are eager to learn something in space technology, maybe participate in space technology activities at a later point in their life, in their careers. So welcome all of you. I can't stop talking without showing this slide. This slide is about distant galaxies, and also showing our Milky Way, where we are in a very small planet, such a tiny location in the mammoth of the things. So you are nobody there, if you really look at the whole of the universe. Interest in space technology comes out of this simple image, that it's too huge. And you are nothing in the middle of the whole thing. And it is our destiny, it's our desire, the human beings, is to explore the strange new worlds and seek out new life and new civilizations and go boldly to places where no man has ever gone. This is something that keeps all of us very interested in space technology. And so is the case with me. Space technology or activities related to launch vehicles and satellites and missions, though we are doing something of this nature, finally, the human civilization's goal is something that we are progressing day by day when we work on small things in Vikram Sarabhai Space Center and in ISRO. So that's why I'm inspired to show you this slide. And the same thing with another slide which I want to show you is the rocket technology. To travel from Earth to any other place on this universe, you need to overcome the gravity field of Earth. Right? So for that, you need to gain velocity. You have only one technology known today to human being, and that is rocket. Chemical rocket propulsion. Using that only, you can travel from Earth to any other heavenly body, or even go to another distant planet or to another galaxy. There is no other non-technology today other than rocket, chemical rocket propulsion. So all of you are aware of that. And what I'm shown here is the launch of GSLV Mark III. Correct? So I'm very proud to show the rocket which I have participated to design along with my teammates. And that is flying very successfully in one of its flight. So I will go to the probability of ISR. So what I have shown here is a collage of two pictures. One is a sounding rocket being launched from Tumba, and another is a man standing on the moon. You know who he is, the first man on the moon. And most of these two events happened almost at the same time. Americans were capable of designing rockets and take man to moon. Were just beginning to understand rocket science and technology by launching small rockets from the shores of Tumba near Thiruvananthapuram. We were just taking our baby steps long back in 1960s. So we are more or less overcome that big gap it existed between India and the rest of the world in terms of space science and technology. That is what is important. In 60s, we were so behind, but with our dedicated effort of so many scientists and engineers, over the last 5 decades, we were able to overcome this gap. And we were now able to design our own rockets, our own satellites, and launch them from Indian soil and take it even up to Mars successfully. And that is very important. Future is important to me. I'll start talking about ISRO. We cannot forget about these two great men. One is Vikram Sarabhai and Satish Dhawan. Vision and later the program and the managerial capability to design our destiny. And based on their vision only, currently the whole programs of ISRO is structured. Aware of their contribution, so I don't want to elaborate. But the most important part of their contribution is that the beginning itself, they talked about applications. Just make some rockets and launch, or just to show it as a symbol of power, but they were using it as a tool for communicating with the masses and then showing that the space technology has an ability to touch the lives of the human beings or the countrymen. Satellite from US, unit equipments from France, and also from equipments from Russia. We were able to demonstrate many technologies in 70s. One of them is what you are showing here is a television broadcasting that happened even before the television broadcasting started in India. Using a satellite which is hired from America, villages, antenna was set up and television broadcast was shown using the setup, using the space technology at that time. And based on this, you know, demonstrations only, slowly, our ISRO got enough funds and research support from government, and we were able to build upon it. So that is important message. So people are centric space research. That is what we are talking about. So we started with the small rockets launches in the church building. All the story you are knowing, you know about the RH-75. You also know about the TERLS, Tumba Equatorial Rocket Launching Station, and this dedication to United Nations by our Prime Minister. All these stories you are aware of, so I won't spend time on it. But I will spend time on one of the important events in 19... This were the times when I joined ISRO. I joined ISRO in 1985. So just 3 years after my joining, I was seeing a failure of a launch. The flight was just breaking apart. TAM and SLV-3 successful launch. But even after that, the rocket which we designed were falling down, and we were not knowing how it is happening. Those were the times so much of public adulation was not there for ISRO. We were not being congratulated for fantastic achievements. We were criticized. In fact, when I was in ISRO, we were all shouted at by public. Why you people are all throwing all the rockets to the sea? I know, always sea launching vehicle. That was how we were, you know, ridiculed at that time. But slowly we understood this technology very well. We were able to understand how rockets fly safely, how to design it very well. And then after this failure, there were no major failures until now. Though there were minor problems in the missions, which always happen in rockets, we were able to understand. This is a very important mission in the history of ISRO. We were able to understand how rockets function and what are the technologies required to fly complex machines like this. Through the failures, we really understood. And even after failure, the most important part is we did not leave it, and we worked upon it very dedicated manner. Not me alone, many of the scientists at that time, because I was just a junior at that time, and I was seeing all this happening in this organization. And through that learning, that we are able to design new rockets, which I'll show you quickly to all of you. So today we have a big array of rockets. We have started from sounding rockets in 1960s through SLV-3, ASLV. Today we have many rockets on our own. And we are also having many technological progress developments going on in the bottom part of the slide. You can see many of them, which I'll explain quickly at a later point of the slides. Okay. Now coming to satellites, we have so many communication satellites today. So you know that where those communication satellites are placed, they are all placed in the equatorial orbit. So at 36,000 kilometer up in the sky, we have 18 communication satellites of ISRO currently in service. Some of them are nearing end of their life. Some are still working. Some are newly added. So right now, 18 communication satellites are there, spread across this equator, serving this the whole country and the neighborhood. So that is very important asset. We have to manage them and we have to run them. Another important set of satellites which are currently there are the navigation satellites meant for NAVIC. There are 7 satellites which are now currently there. It is at the same equatorial geosynchronous or GSO orbits, but they are supporting the navigation support. And they were called the IRNSS series of satellites, and they provide positioning support like your GPS and a time accuracy less than 40 nanoseconds. And I will tell you about the service and support provided by this NAVIC to Indian area. Two things it does. One is the IRNSS cluster gives you very important positioning support, like the equivalent to our GPS. It also gives for mobiles, this positioning linked applications it can run. Another important satellites based service is called Gagan. Gagan is a support which is given to aircrafts. When aircrafts are flying, while landing time, they need a lot of navigation support. So using the Gagan, that is GPS aided geo augmentation navigation, which is sitting in some of the satellites called GSAT-8, GSAT-10 and GSAT-15, we are able to provide the service to the aircrafts for precise navigation under very severe weather or rain or visibility conditions are poor. They can do autonomous landing activities. So this is a very important support that we are giving through the satellite services today. Sector where we have satellites are Earth observation. The satellites are the eyes in the sky. So you can watch our country and all other countries in the globe. There is no limitation that whether we can watch our country or other country. But we have different type of satellites to look at Earth. There are some satellites which will look at land and water part. There are another satellite which will have a high resolution images. There is another set of satellite looking at ocean. And there is another set of satellites which looking at weather and climate prediction. So there are different types of satellites and different applications we have. We also have resolutions which are 1 kilometer. That is the least count that you can see in a picture is 1 kilometer. We also have resolutions as big as 0.65 meters of resolution. So sub-meter resolution. So we can have different types of resolution, and we don't require always high resolution. For example, land and water study, you don't really need very high resolution. And you don't need for ocean studies very high resolution. But when you want to look at cartography to understand terrains of the Earth and also to look at boundaries, etc., and looking at objects moving on the road like cars, people, you need high resolution images. So we have different class of images, which also includes clouds mapping, cyclone mapping, etc. So this is yet another class of satellites we have already in service. Another important class of satellites are called satellites which are meant for digital revolution. High bandwidth connectivity for your internet penetration, for your TV broadcasting, for your high data rate connectivities. We have the following satellite: GSAT-19, GSAT-29, GSAT-11, GSAT-20, all launched. You just look at it, 2018, 2019 timeframe, these were launched. These are the recent satellites which are meant to give you the digital connectivity to the entire country. As much as 100 Gbps is the target that we have put to provide through the satellite. So it's a very important program for us. So in summary, if I look at ISRO today, this slide is very important education for you. We can tell you that we have already made 189 space missions, 96 spacecrafts, 75 launch vehicle missions, 18 technology-driven missions, 10 student satellites we have launched, 7 dedicated satellite launches of foreign satellites in PSLV. 319 foreign satellites we have launched for 33 countries. Till now, we have lifted 15.8 tons of mass into orbit. And the biggest mass we have ever lifted using is the GSAT-11, which was 5,854 kilogram. So we have different launch vehicles today, and these are the type of total spectrum that we achieved and operating currently in ISRO. And I will show you next slide, the satellites currently in service. Totally 49 satellites are there currently in orbit, Indian satellites, 18 communication satellites, 8 navigation satellites, 20 Earth observation satellites, 3 science missions, including Mars Orbiter, AstroSat, and Chandrayaan-2. And so you look at the spectrum, all of the satellites we have to simultaneously operate, drive, and get the data. And so it's a big set of people working in the ground as well as, you know, controlling the satellites and taking the data from them and servicing various sectors. So it is not only launching and making satellites, but operating them is also a very complex process. Now, I'll quickly go through some of the technology part of it, propulsion and space transportation system developments. This I'll go through very fast. Please pardon with me because you may be aware. PSLV was an important rocket. We had the 50th successful launch in the December 2019. So very important part of the launch vehicle. And in PSLV, we can put satellites in whichever way you want. So some of the pictures you see, very interesting ways the satellites have been mounted and launched. You remember in PSLV, we have launched even 104 satellites in one launch. You are aware of it. And we have launched them in different configurations, different ways. Whoever wants to launch in PSLV are all welcome. You build one satellite and come to us, we will launch you whatever way you build. So that's how it is. And GSLV is also an operational launcher today. We had 5 successful missions. Last 5 were very successful. After initial troubles it had, it is now proved to be a very successful rocket and operational today. And another is the GSLV Mark III, where it had done the experimental flight, the GSLV Mark III X-CARE mission, which I was the mission director. And later it has gone through 3 further missions very successfully. And this rocket has done the Chandrayaan-2 mission and also will be the one which will take the human missions, Gaganyaan, to our Indian human spaceflight mission. This same rocket will be converted for human spaceflight mission. So this is an array of new rockets. The one which is already operating, the PSLV, from the left to right, I am telling you, the first one is the PSLV, then the GSLV, GSLV Mark III. Then we have a new rocket called SSLV. We are developing an orbital launch vehicle, ORV, vehicle, TVP. We are developing the Gaganyaan rocket called the GSLV Mark III HSP. And then a heavy lift booster we are trying to develop. And then a fully liquid stage based human spaceflight mission rocket called HLV-HSP also is in the design phase. So we have full of work in new rockets in ISRO today. And we have different types of propulsion system, liquid, solid, cryo, semi-cryogenic, hyperbolic, non-hyperbolic. So any type of propulsion we talk about, we are developing here and then manufacturing them. We have an array of solid rockets, big ones, 200 ton propellant to few grams of propellant in a rocket. So from very big ones to very small ones, we are able to design and manufacture solid rockets. This here, the fuel is in solid form. It is like a paste and cured like rubber. There is another set of rockets called liquid engines and liquid rockets. So some of the pictures which I am showing here, liquid engines are very complex engines. In fact, I was the center director for liquid propulsion development before I took over here. So I am reasonably familiar with these developments in liquid engines and cryogenic engines. So they are very complex engines. So I'll quickly show you some pictures of engines. There are small engines with the 75 millinewton thrust to as much as 2000 kilonewton thrust. Huge engines, which weighs, each engine itself is 3.5 ton. And some of the engines are only a few grams in mass. So there is a wide array of different types of liquid engines that is currently being designed and manufactured by ISRO. So cryogenic engines, I will just show you one or two pictures of cryogenic engine. They are very complex systems. Lot of complex materials are used. Very high temperature at one end, something like 3000 Kelvin at one end, and very low temperatures, minus 0, 20 Kelvin at other end. so much less at the other end. So this engine is design is a very complex activity, and we have mastered and made the first true cryogenic engine for GSLV Mark III in the year 2016-17 time frame was a successful flight of this engine. And today we are developing a new engine called semi-cryogenic engine with the 200 ton thrust. This technology is now we have acquired from another country, but we are designing our own and then manufacturing our own in India. Currently, the systems are undergoing testing. Okay. And using this engine, we are developing new schemes of rocket, which will finally replace the current rockets. And because, you know, unlike our present solid rockets, which is very polluting type of rocket, you know, solid propellant, when it burns, it produces hydrochloric acid. So we have want slowly change this chemical propulsion to green propulsion. One of the green propulsion is this semi-cryogenic propulsion, where we are using kerosene and liquid oxygen. So finally, the output is only water and carbon dioxide. And cryogenic propulsion is the best, where the output of the burning product is only water, steam only. But we can't put cryogenic propulsion everywhere. Some places we have to go for semi-cryogenic. So long term, we are planning to put all propulsion to cryogenic and semi-cryogenic, which will be much more safer. So that is another area of development currently going on. And yet another development is called methane engine. You know, you have heard of methane? Methane is a gas which is used in your cooking gas. You know, your house cooking gas mostly contains 95% is methane. And using that in the liquid form and along with oxygen, you can burn in engine. And that is the one which is meant for future. And many people in the world have already developed. And we are also developing similar engines. And one of them is getting ready for testing currently in our liquid propulsion center. Yet another rocket we are now developing. This is currently being developed. This we have started only 2 years back. This is called small satellite launch vehicle. So after making big rockets like PSLV, GSLV and GSLV Mark III, we are now going to make a small rocket. This is slightly bigger than our SLV-3. But why? The question is, why we are making a small rocket when we are already knowing how to build a big rocket? Because big rockets are very costly and it will take time to assemble them, launch them, takes months to prepare. And suppose you build a satellite and I want to launch in 1 week. Can you launch? No, it will take many months to prepare and launch. So today we are developing a rocket called SSLV, which can be assembled in a week's time, launched in 24 hours, very quickly. And also its cost is very, very small so that people can afford it. Suppose some industry developed a rock satellite of say 300, 400 kilogram and they want to launch. They can approach and then launch within very short time at a lower cost. So this is the future. So for considering the small satellites coming up in large numbers, so we are developing this rocket as an option. And after developing, ISRO will not be launching it. It will be handed over to an industry in India who will build it and launch. So this is another proposal we have. Yet another work we are doing is an air breathing engine called scramjet. There is no moving part in this engine. Air enters the engine. It will get compressed to you because it is flying at a hypersonic speed, and then fuel will be injected. The fuel here is kerosene, and it will develop thrust and it will move forward very high speeds, and it will work for 250 seconds in the current design. And this can be operated using one of our liquid stages. So this is also under development, and the future is that when you have air breathing engine, our liquid fuel oxidizer need not have to be carried in the rocket. We can take the air from outside, compress it, and then use that air as a source of oxygen. Only fuel alone we need to carry. That's the advantage of such an engine. So this shows a picture of that rocket currently we are designing and developing. It is under the design phase today called scramjet research vehicle. Okay. So here, the technology here is we have already proven in one of the small rocket launches, but now it is a bigger size. We had to use complex materials and manufacturing technology to make this rocket. So there lies a big challenge. Another area we are working is called electric propulsion. Electric propulsion is energy is taken from solar power, sun energy, and that will be converted into electricity, and that electricity will be used for generating thrust. But we cannot, just electricity alone is not enough. You have to carry a gas called xenon gas. And the xenon gas will be converted to ions using this electricity, and that will produce thrust. But thrust is very, very small. But the efficiency is 5 times, 10 times of the present chemical rocket engine. So we need to carry very small quantity of the xenon gas, but we can work it for a very long time and produce the thrust. That's the advantage. So we already made such engines and flown in one of our satellites of ISRO, and we are now currently working on bigger engines. So currently one of them is 300 millinewton. We are planning to develop engines up to almost 1 newton. 1 newton, you know, it is very small number. Still, it is a very big number for satellites. It is good enough for satellites to go to GTO. So such engines are the promising future. And many of the satellites currently being launched are using this type of engines. So we are also working on it. And we are developing an important technology called vertical landing. This you would have seen, you know, some of the people like Elon Musk has developed a rocket which will go launch a satellite, come back and land in 4 legs. So we are also working on similar technology called vertical demonstration of, you know, landing of rocket using one of our rocket engine. So this is the details of the design, which I am not going into the details. It is called test vehicle, and finally it will be tested using a vertical landing capacity. Yet another development we are doing is a winged rocket. You know, you know space shuttle, all of you know space shuttle had wings and used to land in the land using wheels in a runway. So similar space shuttle, this is an Indian space shuttle we are trying to develop. And this is not for human beings to travel. There is a difference. Here nobody will travel, but it will go to orbit. It will open its door. It will put the satellites in the orbit and come back and land in a landing strip. So we did a test sometime back. This was a demonstration of the test. It went to sea and did a demonstration of landing in the sea without wheels. So this time we are planning to launch it and then make it land on the landing strip. So that experiment is currently, you know, planned, and we are getting ready for it. The launch vehicle is just ready, and we will be testing it soon. And you will know it about the news in the newspapers. Maybe after the COVID time is over, we will be getting ready for the launch. We are working on a heavy lift rocket also. See, currently we are able to launch 5 tons, 6 tons to launch, but we want to increase the capacity to almost 10 tons to launch to GTO. So various designs are happening for this rocket, and we are currently working on a heavy lift version. It will be a very big one. The size will be, you know, it's almost 5 meter diameter. Can you imagine what will be 5 meter? It will be much bigger than your room size. That will be the diameter, and the height will be almost 70 meter tall. 70 meter is how many floors? 25 floors, maybe 23, 24 floors high, that tall vehicle it will be. And you will be able to lift almost 10 tons to GTO. So that's a huge rocket we are currently conceiving now. Now let me talk about a little bit of human space flight missions. Okay. And human space flight is, you know, all of you know Gaganyaan program. And the whole idea of Gaganyaan mission and our ability to fly human being comes out of our ability to bring back a satellite from orbit safely to Earth. The most important part of human space flight is what? It's not taking the man to the space, but most important part is bringing him back safely to Earth. Unless you are able to bring him back safely to Earth, you cannot put him in orbit and then kill him, no? So we did a demonstration in 2007 called Space Capsule Recovery Experiment. This was an interesting experiment done using PSLV. We sent a capsule to orbit. Using a propulsion system, we reduced the speed and brought it back precisely to a location in sea and landed it in sea, and we collected using ship. So once you can do this in a controlled manner, then you know how to send a satellite to orbit and then bring him back. So we know how to bring him back. And we also did a recent test called a pad abort test, crew escape system test. This is also important test where suppose a man is inside the rocket and something happens to the rocket and it is going to explode. We can quickly escape from the rocket and then save the human being and bring him back safely using a parachute to land or in the sea. So he will not have any problem. Only the rocket may get damaged. So once you have these two knowledges, how to save the human being and how to bring him back from orbit, we can work on the next step called the Gaganyaan, the human space flight program. Here, we are working on develop a human habitable space capsule to carry up to 3 human beings to low Earth orbit and return safely to a predetermined destination on Earth. So this is a goal. And during this time, we will also do a lot of experiments for the purpose of science. And we are going to use our GSLV Mark III for the purpose. And we are currently designing many of the systems today. A lot of progress is being made. And in VSSE, me along with many other engineers are fully involved in the design of this rocket and the human capsule. I'll show you only small details of it because many of the details I can't show in public. So sorry that I can't go finer details into it. But you pardon me, but I'll show you the most important part is what is shown the crew module, the inside the brown color item. Inside this, three of our crew will sit. And what you are seeing top that straight long part is called crew escape system. Anything happens to the rocket, this will take the crew along with the crew module and safely move it to at least 2 kilometers away, and then parachutes will come and make it land in the sea. So it is a very complex mechanism, a lot of computers, a lot of decision making on board, a lot of programming, and very safe way of working. So many things are involved in this, and we are currently developing each of these systems for the human spaceflight program. Okay, so it will be like this. It will, after launching, it will be in an orbit, a 400 kilometer orbit. It will move around the Earth in so many orbits, maybe for a week or so. It will start from the red dot here, the Sriharikota. It will go around the Earth, not one time, multiple times. But in one of the time when it is coming back, it will be returning maybe near the Africa. We will fire the engine. It will come back and land somewhere near in the Gujarat coast in the sea. And with our ships will go and collect it. So this is a plan. And during this time, they will do some experiments. So we are developing many, many complex systems for this, including our ships, which are required for locating, recovering, all those things are involved in this mission. It's a very challenging mission. It's not done by ISRO alone, by so many people, including Indian Air Force and various institutions in this country. It's a very interesting mission. Now let me talk about some technology and indigenization. Indigenization, you understand indigenization. Indigenization is some, we have been buying things from outside the country, but we cannot no longer buy. You are knowing about China's problem, recent issues. We have been heavily dependent on countries like China for import of many items and technologies. Slowly, India should stand on its own leg, and we should be able to build things in India itself, using our own technology, our own manpower. So this thrust is so much there in India. So when we started in ISRO, many of the materials and electronics, everything we were used to buy from outside, slowly, we are able to use our Indian products in rockets. And almost 90% of our content in rockets is now currently Indian origin. So that is an element of technology and indigenization. But still, there is a 10% still in the rocket from outside. And slowly, over the years, we have to reduce it. And most of it is in the form of electronics. Electronics is still a very important item. Still, India is far behind. So I'll just show you 4 or 5 slides for you people to understand what are the key technologies that we need to develop and then master. One item I am showing you called lithium-ion cell. Lithium-ion cell, in each of your mobile phones, there is a battery. That battery is a lithium-ion battery. Not a single lithium-ion battery is made in India. Everything comes from, where it is coming from. So in India, there is only one place it is made, that is in ISRO. Today, lithium ion cells are made in ISRO, and this is flying in our satellites and rockets, and we are making in VSSE today. There is high capacity lithium ion cells, and we have transferred this technology to Indian industries. You can make it and you can sell it and use in our industry. So this is one area. We can use it for mobile phones, you can use it for electric cars, and we are also making new items called supercapacitors. Very high energy storage devices, which are useful for scooters and cars like that. And we have transferred this technology to 6 industries recently. Yet another complex technology is called composites. Composites are materials which are not metal, but they are made of carbon or Kevlar materials along with adhesives. They form very strong materials. They can make materials much stronger than steel, but very light in weight. And this is essential for rockets and aircrafts. Typical standard aircrafts, almost 50-60% as composites. And rockets are also some 20-30% is made of composites. This technology is still difficult technology, and it is not much in India. We are still importing many of this. So slowly we are developing the skills in India to build it within India. slowly, this is going to be one of the key technology will determine our future. Materials, super alloys. You know, copper, aluminium, steel, you know, many materials you know. But the materials we use in rockets are not just steels or aluminiums or iron. They are complex materials called ceramics, metal ceramics. They can take very high temperatures, like 1,500 or 2,000 degrees, will not melt. And materials like columbium. And using that only we are making our engines. And making this aluminium and steel and alloys, it's a very high technology. We have a lot of industries and research establishment in this country who is making it. And earlier we used to import so much from outside. Today, everything is made in India. All these complex alloys are made in India. You should be proud about that aspect. We also working on additive manufacturing. Have you heard of additive manufacturing? How to build the materials using powders and make them fuse and then make it into shapes. Instead of machining metal out of this, this is a new technology. I think you young people should learn, read about additive manufacturing and be prepared for the future. Because all of your items, even your food also will be additively manufactured. Your cloth will be additively manufactured. Your shoes will be made additive manufacturing. Everything in the world is going to be additively manufactured. So we are also working on rocket parts using additive manufacturing process. Chemicals and polymers. So many chemicals we require for rockets. Almost, I can tell you, almost 100 different chemicals are required to make a rocket. And all of them are made in India using the technology that we have made within VSSC. And it is transferred to industry. I'm not going into the details. Ceramics. Lot of ceramic materials. You know, have you heard of ceramics? Your porcelain glass is a ceramic. But lot of ceramics are required in electronics products, IC chips, radio frequency equipments, and various nozzles and high hot items, etc. And all the ceramic technology we have, and we are indigenizing them and making it within this room. We are also working on electronics. Electronics, I told you, still a lot of them are coming from outside. Your mobile phones, entire electronics is imported. Not a single part is made in India. You know that. But in India, the biggest electronics manufacturing industry is in ISRO. Probably you will not know that. It is in Chandigarh, Punjab. We have a SCL, the Silicon Laboratory, and that is a part of ISRO. There we are making our own computer chip. And that computer chip, Vikram, is flying in our rockets. You should be proud about that aspect. We were able to design our own computer and make our own chip, and we are not buying from outside this type of chips. Now we are trying to build them using our own industry, private industry as well as SCL, semiconductor complex also. Now let me talk about a little bit on science and exploration. Now this is the most fascinating part of space technology. So Chandrayaan 1, all of you know Chandrayaan 1, it was launched in 2008 using PSLV, and this is the first mission to Moon. And this was a very successful mission. We had 10 instruments on board, both Indian and foreign. And we were able to keep that Chandrayaan 1 in orbit for a very long time. And this is the mission which found out water on the Moon. That you know, all of you know, right? And this mission, using an US instrument, we were able to identify water on the Moon. And after that, you can watch that lot of interest in Moon, you know, world over. I think that is something that is a, you know, pathfinder mission, really. The interest in Moon again rekindled. The most important part of this mission is Indian mission is different from other people because of the strategy that we used to go to Moon. We had a very small capacity rocket called PSLV. We had very small mass, 1,400 kilogram, but we were able to still go to Moon using the novel technique called this, what is Srinath, the third picture. Slowly rising the orbit, slowly rising by rotating around the Earth and making the ellipse bigger and bigger and bigger and finally reaching up to the Moon and entering the Moon. This is the first time that anybody in the world has used to go to Moon. And because of this novel approach of mission planning and thing, we got the award from International Academy of Astronautics for making the Chandrayaan mission first time successfully. And along with this, we did build the deep space network also for Chandrayaan mission. And because of such big antenna, this is a 32 meter diameter antenna. Can you imagine 32 meter? How big is it? How big it will be? So because of this antenna, we were able to later communicate even up to Mars. So that is the biggest finding. And of course, in the bottom, we are shown the determination of the hydroxyl ions on the surface of Moon, which is found out using the instruments on Chandrayaan 1. And Mars orbital mission is the next major accomplishment, again achieved using PSLV rocket. And this, all of you would have read, in 2013 we launched and took it almost an year. In 2014, September, it reached the Mars and we had a successful Mars insertion. And this satellite was supposed to serve only 6 months after that insertion on 24th September. But I want to tell you that it is still working very well and it is still sending a lot of data mapping the surface of Mars. And this is a really a majestic achievement. And India is the very first country which was successfully gone to Mars in its very first attempt. And you should all be proud of our achievements. This is what I shown in the first slide, that the 50 years of, we were behind the others, but by this single mission, we became one of the top leading spacefaring nations of the world. So Mars orbital mission strategy also, I'm not going to explain. It is similar to what we did for Moon. We slowly increase the orbit and final Martian transfer trajectory, which took almost 300 days. We left after some time and that was precisely controlled and reached up to Mars. And don't think that going to Mars is an easy target, because Mars moves at tremendously high speed. And that is the same thing for the Mars orbiter also. So meeting them precisely at the right point and right time is a trick. And we were able to do it very well through using our own ground system and commanding and precision navigation. That is the most important trick of this mission. So we had the Mangalyaan mission, and it is a tremendous achievement. We should all give a big hand to all the people behind this project. And another important mission that is coming up is Aditya mission. You all of you know Aditya L1 mission, and this is an interesting mission. The satellite is just getting ready. It will be put at Lagrangian point L1, where it will look at the sun for a very long time and study the coronal ejection using its coronagraph and UV imager, soft and hard X-ray imagers, spectrometers, particle experiments and magnetometers. So all these instruments will measure the field around the sun and study the sun. Why sun study is important? Because sun is the one which affects our life. The life in Earth is affected by the what is happening in sun. Recently, there is a study given that the sunspot activity has something to do with even tectonic movements, even earthquakes are linked to sun's activity. There is a study recently. I do not know whether it is right or wrong, but everything has some bearing on activities on sun. So it is important to study the sun, and we are doing that mission, and the satellite is getting ready. And we have many scientific missions which we accomplished: Chandrayaan 1, Mars Orbiter, AstroSat. AstroSat, I forgot to tell you, it was launched in 2015. Still, it is working very well. This is the first observatory that we have launched in our orbit, and we are able to look at planetary evolution, finding out new planets and the exploding planets, nebulas, etc. And a lot of publications have come out of the findings of AstroSat. Chandrayaan 2, all of you are knowing that we did an attempt to land on the moon, soft land, but it was not successful in the last phase. But further, we are working on future Chandrayaan missions. Chandrayaan 3, currently we are working, and the satellite definition is very clear, and we will wait for the next opportunity for this launch to take place in the GSLV Mark 3 mission. Currently, the lander design and development and manufacturing is going on. Hopefully, this time we will be able to make the landing perfect after learning mistakes. As you said, once you make a mistake, you will never make it again, hopefully. Another interesting work is the PSLV 4 stage. You know, every launch of PSLV, there is a satellite which is sitting on top, and there is a fourth stage of the satellite, rocket, which is left as a debris. So we have converted the debris of the stage into a useful platform. And using many missions, we have demonstrated how to convert the left-out part of the rocket into a useful payload platform. And using this, lot of experiments we are going to do. In the coming days, we are going to power it with solar panel. We are going to give the autonomous capacity to do experiments, commanding from Earth, and do robotic arms. We are going to fix it and sometimes do a debris collection or do some imaging of Earth or do some experiments for young people from colleges, etc. So this will become a platform for anybody who wants to conduct an experiment in space without building a satellite. So that is a interesting thing that we are trying to do using our PSLV 4th stage. It's a very important innovation that nobody in the world has ever done. So that's why it is important. Low-cost experiment platform. In space science, we have done a lot of missions. Chandrayaan 1, Mars Orbiter, AstroSat, Chandrayaan 2, now Chandrayaan 3, I discussed. There is ExpoSat, Aditya L1, Mars Orbiter 2. There is a mission to Venus, Lunar Polar Mission, ExoWorlds. So all these are new science missions currently in the planning stage. ExoWorld is an interesting mission. It is a mission to look at exoplanets. Exoplanets are the planets which is there for other stars like Sun. There will be other solar systems. So there could be planets. And how to study these planets? Study its chemical composition, atmosphere, etc. So we have a spectrometer which will sit on these exoworlds and observe the exoplanets and then study its constitution. So this is an interesting mission which is in collaboration with our Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology. Similarly, there are other missions like payloads and joint missions. ISRO is not working alone in science. We have a collaboration with various people, like in French collaboration, in NASA, we have collaboration for NISR, NASA, ISRO Synthetic Aperture Radar. We have collaboration with JAXA, the Japan Space Agency, for lunar polar mission. So there are a lot of collaboration happening between various international agencies. So let me talk about the first points which I mentioned, how to benefit all this activity to the public and public at large. It is very important how this is beneficial to the country. This aspect must be discussed with you people anyway. So our ISRO space application has various areas which we are addressing. One of them is governance, how to use it for administration, how to use it for sustainable development of the country, how it can use for socio-economic security, disaster risk reduction. So for that various area, for example, governance, planning, monitoring, evaluation, decision support, sustainable development, look at climate change, impact assessment, geobiosphere studies. For socioeconomics part, how to do food and water, energy and health, shelter, infrastructure, information, support, how we can give through space imaging. Disaster risk reduction, you know, how cyclone warning, early warning, etc., and climate related warning that you can give, flood warning we can give. So all of this you can read in this book. This is a book called Little Known Triumphs of the Indian Space Program, written by one of our additional secretary, Sri S.K. Das. If you can get hold of this book from library somewhere, please read and you will understand how this is prepared in a very, very interesting way he has written in this book. Currently, ISRO is running 158 new projects with 60 ministries. You think that ISRO is working only for rockets and satellites? Sorry, we are not working that alone. We are working with the various departments, administrative wings. It is one of our important work. We work with the telecommunication department. We work with water department. We work with forestry. We work with the land revenues. We work with IMD and so many institutions we work. We collaborate and propose projects and many of the Indian programs, the Atmanirbhar Bharat, that various Namami Genge, Skill India, Digital India programs. We are part of all of this. And we produce programs to support all this activity through whatever technology we have in our hand. It is a very important activity of ISRO. So we support the governance, geospatial governance, which includes, for example, crop insurance. Probably you will not know. Suppose you are a big farmer and you have to insure the crops. And if there is something gets damaged, a crop loss is occurring, insurance companies want assessment. And we can provide that assessment using our images. Similarly, Clean India program, we can assess water in rivers. There is a housing scheme to assess how land can be utilized for housing purposes. So a lot of support we can give using various imaging what is happening in using our satellites. Similarly, watersheds. Watersheds are where we have collection of water and how it can be efficiently utilized for agriculture. So a lot of such support activity we are doing through our satellite applications. I am not going into all of them. One of them I can tell you is a potential fishing zone. Probably you would have heard about them. That using our satellites, which will measure the plankton the color of the water, the temperature of the water, you can predict how much fish catch can be there in one location and inform the fishermen and go and catch the fish there. So you don't have to go around the sea and searching for it. You can collect the information at the port and go where the latitude, longitude information is available and catch the fish from there. Similarly, we can give early warning and hazard assessment to various places. So all these are finally the support that we are going to the administration. And for this, whatever money we are spending in space program is returning the benefits to the public. We have a portal called Bhuvan. So some of you, please click on your internet and then check Bhuvan. Okay, Bhuvan.com. You just try and then you will be able to see Indian Geo platform where we provide India specific information. It's not a global platform, it is India specific, and you can read the from the front the, what all information it can give, more than it can give from Google Earth or any such similar service providers. It is an India specific, it gives so much information, and for a public there are some limited information, but for a government user with a login rights you can see much more information. For example, one of the information I am telling you, you can talk about all the post offices of this country. Where will you find the information? A specific post office, where it is, what type of assets it has got, it is there. Island information, archaeological information, rivers, water bodies, croppable lands, dry lands, and where the water can be found out. Every information related to India is there in this portal. It is something that ISRO is working and creating for the country. In the future, ISRO wants to work on various future programs, like missions, like Mars we are working on, probably we may land in, we will explore new exoplanets, we may go to moon and bring some samples, we may do deeper space missions. Similarly, we will build space stations once you have a human spaceflight capacity. We will also carry out extravehicular activities, robotic missions, human missions to moon and Mars. I am not sure about it because by 2050, you people are going to lead the space program, not me. So whatever predictions I make has to be made real by you young people, not you alone, but the people who are the younger people of this country. Similarly, we will be building our navigation cluster much more bigger. We may have a large constellation of satellites serving our country with the space solar propulsion. And rockets also will become different. Rockets also will become reusable fully. And we may build a nuclear propulsion rockets, green propulsion technologies, and super heavy lift, like 100 tons plus lifting capacity. If you have to go to moon with a lot of people and Mars to a lot of people, you need huge rocket, like 150 ton capacity. So all this will happen in 2050. It is a vision and it's a goal all of us have. And all these are finally for a country which is stronger. So in beyond 2020, we want the nation to be a strong nation where you will be able to large scale operationalize the production of the industry, the rockets and satellites using Indian industries and startups, and finally make an inclusive growth for the whole country. So ISRO programs in various sectors like tele-education, telemedicine, our disaster management and support systems should actually support our government programs like education for all, health for all, employment, etc. And then finally result in a strong country. This is our goal. And for this, ISRO plays a very small part. The space activity is not a solution for every problem, but we can help in a small way to solve a one problem or a few problems the country faces. That itself is worth it. So with that, let me thank you for an interesting listeners. And I seek all your comments and questions. Then we will get into a discussion if you wish. Some of the opinion from you can give, and also questions can be given. Okay, thank you. See, I want to tell you, the ISRO has all types of people. ISRO has scientists, engineers, physicists, chemicals, chemists, agriculturists, bioscience people, ocean science people, biologists, teachers. Now you can name them, all class of people are there. So it is most important that you have to be best in your area, whichever area you like to become. For example, you must be, if you are a social scientist or a lawyer, you may not be able to join ISRO. Of course, you can work in various other fields. But in ISRO, you need not have to be a scientist. You can be an engineer. You can even study physics and do your master's, do your PhD. You can be a researcher in physics. You can do so in chemistry. You take your PhD or science master's in chemistry or in plant science. The Indian Institute of Science, Space Science and Technology director is a plant science PhD holder. Just imagine. So people with even that background can become a space scientist. So there is no limitation for what area you are interested. You can even become a fisheries expert and then help us in the fisheries identification, how to identify using satellite technology. So there are a lot of opportunities for any field people who wants to work in space. Space is only an enabler, provider. So whichever field you are interested in studying, study or learn very well. You be the best in that area. So that's all what is required. There will be an opportunity either in ISRO or anywhere else. Once you are good at what you are doing, the opportunities will automatically come. That's all I want to tell you.
Can I?
Please introduce yourself and then speak.
My name is Advait. I'm 8.
Okay, Advait, please go ahead.
In the olden days, and before technology was introduced and space was introduced, in space science, satellites, in satellites, why animals were sent?
Why animals were sent? No, that you are referring to what Russians did in the beginning?
Yes, what the other countries did.
But nowadays, nobody is sending animals, no? That you have noted?
Yes, but they'll send humans also.
Yeah, now we are sending humans. We are not sending animals. We are sending only humans, right? See, it is because in the beginning, we were not sure about what is there in space. There were a lot of stories about if you go to space, there will be heavy radiation. You will die within no time. If you get out of atmosphere, human being cannot survive. There are so many speculations at that time, even before the first flight of the man. So because of this concern, people wanted to find out what will happen if living creatures go to space. So they started with the mice and small creatures, then later with the plants, and slowly it went up to Laika, the dog, and many other dogs have gone. And many other living creatures have gone. And from that, they understood. Of course, you need to have certain amount of protection in space, but living beings can still live outside Earth with certain amount of protection. So for getting that confidence, there was no other way but to send some animals at that time. But today, after years of experience we have characterized the space very well. The radiation effects are well understood. And we can protect ourselves in the space. There is no need to send any animals to space conducting experiments. We know how to measure it using our own instruments. There is no need to send anybody. Even human beings to go to space itself is questioned today. You know that we have so much robotic capacity. There is not even necessary that human beings have to go to space to do certain experiments. But human beings have the dexterity of their hand, which is much beyond a robot can provide. That's why still human beings have to go. Right? Okay.
Sir, can I?
Yeah, yes, Rahul is on the line. So Rahul, please ask the question.
Sir, when we have deep space missions or like ExoWorld, which is supposed to be happen in 2028, how do we intend to communicate with our satellites so far away?
No, communication is such a thing that distance doesn't really matter. Because once you send a wave out, it will travel forever. An electromagnetic wave will never be stopped through the space. It will simply travel through space. But, you know, it has a spherical pattern. With the distance, its intensity comes down with the square of the distance. So the farther you are likely to receive very small energy. So only issue with the faraway communication is either you need a very strong signal. You need a powerful signal. You need a very big antenna in the earth to receive the signal. You also need a very big antenna in satellite to receive the signal. But you can, from earth, you can pump in very high power, no limitation. But from satellite, when you send that power, it cannot send very huge power. So what you do is in the earth, you build big antenna and then receive the small amount of power in a big area. So you can communicate to any part in the world, in the universe. There is no issue. You know that we are able to probe deeper into the universe using our telescopes, our antenna system. So very feeble signals itself we can receive and communicate. There is no issue. Second issue is time. Because electromagnetic signals travel at the speed of light and not faster than that. And that is still a big time. For example, from sun to earth, light takes how many minutes? 8 minutes. Almost 8 minutes it takes from sun to earth. So if you are communicating far away, far distant than sun, it will be still longer. So it takes time. So one-way communication and getting a reply, again communicating, it takes time. So you cannot communicate that very easily, like what you communicate across continents. So if you can overcome these two issues, time as well as signal strength, you can communicate anywhere. There is no issue.
Doing the researches on a white hole and black hole? And what is the meaning of white hole?
Pardon, I didn't get the question.
Sir, doing the researches for black hole and white hole?
Oh, there is no research on black hole and white hole like that. See, all of you know what is a black hole? Probably you know it, right?
That of a star.
Recently, there was a finding of a black hole. It was announced a picture of a black hole also, right? See, black hole is still a theoretical presentation. And we are trying to find out and learn. Observation-based assessment of black holes are still a long way to go. Black hole has been conceived as a death of a star, that you know. So the constitution of the black hole, how it goes about and how finally a black hole itself will start radiating energy and then die one day. This all have been put in theory. And now we need to have observations, sufficient number of observations to prove the theory. Now mathematically it is proven today, but it has to be observed and then proven. So currently there are places where black holes have been identified and there are a lot of observations, scientific observation happening today to understand about the structure of black holes and then present the validity of those theories, how good they are. So that is going on. So it's a part of the study of the universe. And this is happening not by ISRO alone. ISRO, there are some certain sector of scientists are looking at these type of things. They are called the outer space observation-based scientists. But there are many various other laboratories in and around the world where they look at such observations. And many of those observations are supported by space-based platforms like the Kepler, the Chandra X-ray, and the telescopes which are there in AstroSat, for example. These are providing the data for these scientists to make observations.
Sir, about ozone layer.
No, about the white star, I have no idea. So I can't answer that question without knowing in greater detail about it. Who told that NASA was the first people who sent the man to the moon? Yeah, that is a, it has to do with so many things. First is, there must be a reason for human beings to go to moon, right? The reason for human being to go to moon originally was the competition between Russia and America for space supremacy. And once that supremacy has taken place and Americans became the first, the interest in that has come down. You have observed that the Russians never went again to moon. Not a single Russian has landed in moon. They could have done it, but they never sent. Only Americans, 13 Americans only went to the moon later. And after that, it couldn't be sustained because it is very costly affair. And you can send them again and again, but what you're going to get out of it? It was a question mark. And big of lot of national worth money was being spent for this program. So slowly, the idea of moon mission, you know, went down and they looked at launching more satellites. And slowly the satellites came about. At that time, there were not many satellites. You would have observed when moon mission was taking place, communication satellites were not many. But later the interest was putting in space stations, you know, looking at Earth and mapping Earth, looking at communication, navigation systems. So all the applications developed post lunar period. So it was more focused on human beings and support the world rather than looking at moon. But today again, moon is becoming interesting because there are further economic opportunity coming up when going to moon. That's why there is still, Americans are now proposing the new, go back to moon again, and they are developing the new rocket called SLS. And SpaceX also is working on future Mars and moon missions. And they have a idea called Moon Gateway, which will be a observatory around the moon where people can go to the observatory, stay there, get down to moon, do experiment, come back to observatory and come to Earth like that. So Americans are proposing a very big moon going plan today. Maybe in another 10, 15 years, it will become a reality. Because they are seeing it is now economically viable because you can, minerals are there, you can mine them, you can, there are reusable rockets coming. So costs have come down. Now the Saturn rocket was very costly. Today it is much more cheaper. The rockets of present generation are much cheaper than Saturn. So it is economically possible to sustain such programs. That's why it is the money that decided the fate of moon missions. Yeah. No, reusable concept has been there for long because Space Shuttle, you know, Space Shuttle was a reusable rocket, but it was partially reusable. It was a winged vehicle, but the solid booster and propellant tank was wasted. Only the orbiter alone came back. That was reused. And the present concept of reusability is not winged one because winged one is very heavy and it is very costly to maintain winged reusable vehicle. So it is still being developed in, even in America, new rockets, new winged vehicles, X series vehicles are currently being developed. But and we are also developing our RLV, but they are not meant for human travel because such vehicles are very costly. Space Shuttle was very, very costly to maintain. In fact, I had a discussion with that team once in the US when I went there. The last cutting mission, they were telling me, you know, it takes so many hours of work, so many people's work, and so much of maintenance to keep it running, and it was not worth it. That's why they closed down. So the reusability today is in a different way. The conventional rocket, how to recover and reuse, that is a present question, and that is the answer given by SpaceX. They have shown that using the retro propulsion, it is possible to bring back the rocket and land vertically using four legs in land or in ships, and then bring it back to launch pad, refurbish and launch. So SpaceX has done a very important steps recently. The rocket, after launching 60 days after that, after the recovery, they have again launched the same rocket recently. So in the last many few years, the most important step in the rocket science as made by SpaceX, reusability is the next step that makes the rockets very, very cheap. And because of the low cost, now more missions are possible and access space becomes cheaper. So more nations can participate, more experiments can be done, more satellites can be sent. That is the advantage of reusability. No, I don't want to tell more deeper into it because the technology per se, nobody gives you just like that. It is not available even today free. So it has to be developed by us. And once you are stronger and capable, then people will share with you. That is how it is. So, and once you have proven that you can handle it, it is available now. Even now, rocket engines are available for sale. If you can buy from Russians, you can buy. Even from Americans, they may be possible to get technology today. But to do our own the first time, you need a lot of knowledge. And this knowledge just like that is not available. We need to train ourselves. We have to get through failures and problems, then master the technology. That is the only solution that we have today. Even liquid engines are very complex technology. For example, even materials used for liquid engines, I told something in the presentation, they are very special materials, not ordinary materials. And similarly, there are I can't explain in words what type of problems that you are actually going to face. Hundreds of problems that you are going to face and which you need so many disciplines, people with so many disciplines to be there with you to solve those problems. Like thermal, fluid flow problems, turbo machinery problems, electronics control, fluid control, manufacturing related issues, so many. So once you have skills of this and once you have made one engine, then it becomes a very child's play. You can make another engine very easily. So it is a question of mastering it's for the first time. So it is like any area. Once you have mastered one area, then you are a master for many more things. That's it. That's the way it is. See, one interesting thing is ISRO is all of us are from ordinary background. No, I am also from a government school in this state. Studied in my own language, Malayalam. Later studied in an engineering college in this state. Studied my master's in Indian Institute of Science. So there are bright people everywhere. We are not taking anybody from IITs in ISRO. Because IIT people are all interested to go and work in US. So they all go there. So rest of the people are left in India. So we take the rest of the bright people available through our competitive examinations or from engineering colleges we take. So our Indian Institute of Science and Technology is there. So from there, all these people are coming. Even scientists in various disciplines are coming from normal colleges and backgrounds. And we train them. The most important part is once you are in ISRO, there is a fantastic set of people here who will be able to help you to become an expert. And once you work here, you become an expert and you can contribute further. And we keep ensuring that the people are very studious. It is not like a Kerala or any state government institution where once you are into the job, you can forget whatever you studied. No, not at all like that. You will remain a very important element in our work is to be a student throughout your career. You will learn new techniques. You said about me that I was a mechanical engineer, but after I joined as a mechanical engineer, I had to study various other aspects of engineering. I had to understand chemical engineering, I had to understand electrical engineering, electronics, manufacturing, and so many other areas. Though I am not an expert in other areas, but I have to understand them and work with those people. And once you do that, you can develop complex systems. And it is not me alone. There are so many people in ISRO who are capable of doing multidisciplinary engineering solutions. So that's how we build systems. So we make people, ordinary people, great by involving them in great works. That's how it is. Okay, thank you so much. Bye bye.
Sir, can I get a question? Sir? Yes, sir, I'm Sahil, and I want to just inquire about the current status of Voyager series satellites that has been sent by NASA in ULIS. Can you explain?
No, I don't have any specific information other than you can find in Google. I don't have any specific information about it.
Yeah, okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you. Bye-bye. See you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. I'm switching off. Bye-bye.